I have been displaced.
We are the voice of millions, but we don't have a voice for ourselves.
कैमरामैन था, उसने सुसाइड कर लिया क्योंकि उसको 3 महीने से पैसा नहीं मिल रहा था.
A reporter will be sent out with just a phone call saying, "Get to so and so place, then we'll tell you the rest."
There are many people who are without a single rupee in their hand today.
You can sit and in a studio and talk garbage, but are you out there exposed? And this to me has been an eye opener. The heartlessness of it all. You know, the heartlessness of it all.
They have brought us stories from the front lines during the pandemic. What you just heard are the voices of Indian journalists. For the first time ever, they unite to tell a story, their own story. Welcome to the first episode of the Probes podumentary on the story of the storytellers.
I got a call from my immediate reporting boss, and I was told that the list has been prepared to send the people on leave without pay. I was told, unfortunately, your name is there in the list.
Pink slips, pay cuts and furloughs. Indian journalists are being fired left, right and center. The coronavirus has displaced many reporters and rendered them jobless.
Yeah, it is. My salary is also cut.
You know, they are firing 150 people on a daily basis. I mean, I don't know, it's so weird, and women are the biggest sufferers.
In a major retrenchment exercise carried out by a premier English television channel before the pandemic, Nadeem Ahmed Ghazmi lost his job, his livelihood and also his wife, as he couldn't take her for an annual medical checkup because along with his job, he also lost his family insurance cover.
Because of not going for annual checkup, last year my wife expired, and I feel somehow or the other that is responsible for that.
Nadeem's life had overturned before the pandemic, but with COVID-19, things have only gotten worse. While a few journalists succumbed to the virus, loss of a salary and a livelihood snuffed out the lives of a few others.
कुछ दिन पहले एक टीवी के टीवी चैनल के जो कैमरामैन था, उसने सुसाइड कर लिया क्योंकि उसको 3 महीने से पैसा नहीं मिल रहा था. उसने साफ अपने सुसाइड नोट में लिखा कि उसे सैलरी नहीं मिल रही थी.
Somebody fainted. I have seen it from my own eyes. Phone came from the HR and the guy fainted.
What is noteworthy here is the fact that most journalists are not being fired for poor performance. They're being shown the door because the pandemic makes a mass layoff exercise valid and tenable.
Saddest part what I hear is even big organizations having thousands of crores, and they also go for retrenchments.
People are being fired at a situation like this because some companies are making less profit. It's not that they are not making profit, they're just making less profit.
For many rich media organizations, journalism is not about public good anymore. It's about private greed. And the pandemic has given them enough reasons and more to sack people like a sacred exercise.
They are all lala. They just look for their business. They just compromise. And who is basically on target is the poor soldiers.
I have seen the big media houses holding their year-end retreats in Maldives and Seychelles and big resorts. So you waste your money like this. Even in this lockdown, if you see, the newspapers are covered with full page jacket ads. If you look at the newspapers, most of them have real estate, big real estate. They have their own buildings. Some of the buildings have been subletted. Owners have not cut down on their lifestyles.
And when it comes to sacking in a newsroom, usually the ones at the receiving end are those who are behind the camera. We are told that the pandemic has also made the jobs of the video journalists redundant.
You know, the first victim is the video journalist. The organization think that camera people's service is not required, because now the reporters themselves are doubling up as video journalists, the camera people. So, and also technology has improved. Now you have your Zoom calls and you have your Google Meets and lots of other technology where people can connect. For example, the guest can just switch on their laptops and start speaking to the anchor who is sitting in the studios.
Journalists are gatekeepers of our society. But these harsh realities of the news industry have hit them where it hurts the most, their morale.
At this point of time, at this age, obviously I cannot struggle like a youngster. One of my senior colleague, I went to meet with my daughter. So he asked ke kya ye karna chahti hai. So I said ki jo sir, she wants fine arts and all. तो बोला हाँ बहुत अच्छा, she doesn't want to be a journalist ना. तो मैंने कहा नहीं नहीं, what I feel is what I have gone through, she should not get into the same profession.
Whatever I say is whatever my responses are my personal opinion. They do not reflect that of my own organization. But I just feel extremely sad that people who are in that bracket of essential services and whose work will guide the society in this situation forward are the ones who have to constantly look over their shoulders to see whether they're having the security, the surety and the safety that they need.
During this pandemic, freedom of the press is limited to just those who own the press. To the reporter on the ground, the fight is no longer for the right to report, but for their inherent and basic right to a livelihood.
I would like to underline that to cost cut by cutting out your most seasoned or your trained or your experienced journalists is actually going to prove very, very counterproductive for a media organization.
At the end of the day, newspapers are about news, and the news comes through news persons. So managers and people who are owners may think that they can do without newsmen, but I can assure you that a few months down the line, when you start discrediting, devaluing journalists, people will stop picking up newspapers, because they buy a newspaper not for anything but just to find out what's happening, and as objectively as possible.
The journalists who have struggled to make ends meet during the pandemic say that they entered this noble profession with idealism, but today their struggles have become their identity.
हम लोग तो वो हैं जो रोज कमाते हैं, रोज खाते हैं, और जब तक काम कर रहे हैं तब तक ही पहचान है, तब तक जिंदा है.
The whole trouble is that it is not only money, it is my identity only. Today in Delhi I am nobody. I have nothing except if my organization identity is not there, I am nobody.
The news media industry has an opinion about everybody and everything, but it has always kept its own cards close to its chest. Its own truth always remained buried while it dug the dirt out of other people's closets. These dirty secrets of some of India's respectable news brands show that owners lack empathy and respect for journalists who bring them stories.
I am just sharing the experience of my colleague. The colleague was informed that you have been laid off, and the next assignment you get is about a jobless in some XYZ industry of about XYZ number of people, and you just contact them and they do a story about it. You just see the irony of it. So what will be going in the mind of that reporter? He might not be able to tell you.
If these stories aren't shocking enough, many media houses in India are notorious for putting out their reporters on the front lines to cover stories related to the pandemic without giving them an insurance cover.
When you are in a position of power in a media house and you're actually putting out your troops to get stories and you do not take care of their medical, in my view, it is criminal. It is criminal.
As somebody very colorfully put it, that the house is on fire, the only people who are getting into the building are journalists and firemen.
Many companies who put their journalists in the line of duty, exposing them to high-risk zones, do not even provide them masks, sanitizers, shields or gloves, leave alone insurance against COVID.
कुछ दिन पहले एक चैनल जो बड़ा बड़ा बहुत बड़ा चैनल है, बहुत बड़ा ग्रुप है, that became the hotspot COVID-19 का. वहाँ जब सबसे पहला केस आया तो वो उसने कहा मेरी तबीयत खराब है, मुझे अच्छा नहीं लग रहा, मुझे लग रहा है कोई प्रॉब्लम है, तो मेरी मुझे मैं काम पे नहीं आना चाहता. तो कहा गया कि क्यों बहाने मार रहे हो तुम कोविड के बहाने मार रहे हो और तुम्हें काम पे आना ऐसे नहीं हो सकता, वरना अपना फिर देख लो तुम. उस कंडीशन में गया, लेकिन जब हालत ज़्यादा खराब हुई उसने कहा तो कंपनी ने सुना नहीं, उसने टेस्ट तक नहीं करवाया. एंड ही वेंट हिमसेल्फ, डॉक्टर को दिखाया, अपना टेस्ट करवाया एंड पॉजिटिव आ गया. उसके बाद उस ऑर्गेनाइजेशन में धड़ाधड़ सारे कई सारे केसेस आ गए, और फिर वहां धमकाया गया लोगों को, ये कहा गया कि आप बाहर नहीं बताओगे कितने केसेस आए.
If organizations are not looking after journalists when they are putting up such a colossal fight in trying to generate news and to cover news at the time of a pandemic which is killing people, then I think it's doing a great disservice to the cause of journalism. And I think the corporate houses or the owners is a manifestation of their criminal intent if they jettison their journalists.
During the first lockdown itself, Prime Minister Narendra Modi classified the media under the essential services category. But many Indian journalists are still struggling to get hold of their bare essentials when it comes to COVID care.
In the US, you have the concept of what's called workman's compensation, which essentially means that even if you're not working full-time, even if you're not eligible for all the benefits, you actually are eligible as somebody who is on a contract, and particularly if that contract involves you getting hurt while you're on the job. So I think we really need to think about this.
While all of humanity is under threat during this pandemic, many journalists continue to fight multiple battles. For some, existence itself is an everyday struggle if they don't speak comfort to power.
Generating news is the easy bit, but raising even one rupiah and doing it truthfully without having to blackmail, without doing dirty things through advertising, through subscription, I think is the most challenging thing. I had been struggling to raise funds and get advertising because ideologically my publication has been, you can say, adversarial, like all journalists have to be towards a party in power.
Amidst all of this, it's the television channels in India that have been in the dock over sensationalist, slanderous and toxic TV debates.
You watch television debates, everyone, people talk down to each other. The more you shout, the amount of garbage and fear and nonsense that television journalism has put out during the pandemic is breathtakingly scary. Uninformed, irresponsible, and in some cases even criminal.
The value is on what you don't have, or the value is on what you missed, or what others have and you don't. Even if someone's done 18 hours of hard work on the ground and comes back home, and on the 19th hour there's something that has happened, you know, the question will always be asked, why don't we have this?
Chase sequences, doorstepping, constant spewing of venom, and at times even igniting communal riots. TV news in India has become a very toxic source of entertainment, with employees feeling overworked and undervalued.
I think the focus has to shift on valuing people, valuing the work that people do in the time that they are there for. And their work is not their life. Their work is a part of their life. So in being able to value that, a journalist can also be a brother, a father, a mother, a sister, may have a hobby to pursue, may need investment in training themselves, may have some very good points, but may be needing assistance on some other points.
A majority of the workforce in television channels and the digital media is full of millennials. Many journalists feel experience is no longer considered a virtue in journalism, but a vulnerability.
One of my friends told me that I could have sent your CV to many places, but your experience is the problem, because nobody wants a person with 15 years of experience, and there is no opening for a person like you in the industry.
It's not only the case with television. In Indian journalism across the board, freshers are replacing experienced professionals. Companies say freshers come cheap, they are not resistant to change, and are better equipped at handling pressure compared to experienced journalists.
They don't want anybody. It is like a Chinese product package. You want a good looking out of school guy who you can pay 5,000 rupees. No need of any knowledge, experience or anything. You just give them a script well written, and that is vetted by a senior who is a 15 years, 16 years experienced old person. And you ask that professor newcomer to do a video, and that video gets 1 million views on YouTube, and your job is done.
While it is said that excellence is the best deterrent to sexism, in the news industry it may not be the case. Media houses speak about gender diversity, but they seldom practice it.
Yes, this industry is very sexist. where you're also told that okay fine, if you're tall and you've got long legs, why don't you try wearing a dress.
ये माना जाता है कि फीमेल्स जो हैं वो रात को कौन बुलाए यार, नाइट शिफ्ट में बड़ा मुश्किल है उनको बुलाना, तो इसलिए लड़कियां मत रखो और क्योंकि वो रात को नहीं आ सकती, रात को रोकना मुश्किल है, फिर उनको छोड़ने के लिए गाड़ी चाहिए. जैसे जैसे आप अपने एक्सपेंडिचर्स कम करने की बात करते हो तो जो पिकअप ड्रॉपिंग देते हैं लड़कियों को उसको भी कम करने की बात आती है और उस वजह से लड़कियों पे गिरती है. इट्स ट्रू.
इम्प्लिसिट जेंडर स्टीरियोटाइप्स, बायस एंड वेज गैप्स आर अ पार्ट एंड पार्सल ऑफ मोस्ट वुमेन जर्नलिस्ट्स करियर्स. The harsh reality is that across India's newsrooms, women are still trying to find their rightful place.
The people sitting on the top are men editors. How many of women editors are there in the country?
There's a double whammy here because they continue to assume that it's a second job. So I think women are especially in a bad spot. And to me, it's astonishing that on the one hand, I think Indian women journalists are right on top there in the world. We are second to none. And yet the acceptance of our work, including the money we bring home, is not the same as what a male colleague does. And to me, that's lack of respect.
It's not only sexism. Favoritism over professionalism is another common feature some journalists have to deal with. And this goes beyond gender.
You never really have had that slab. किसको कैसे असेस कर रहे हैं. एवरी ईयर वी फिल अ फॉर्म व्हिच इज केआरएस. नोबडी रियली रीड्स दैट शिट, यू नो. इट्स जस्ट बेसिकली ब्यूरोक्रेटिक बुलशिट दैट यू एक्चुअली आर मेड टू डू इन द नेम ऑफ अप्रेजल्स. एंड देन एवरीबडी इज गिवन द रेजेस दैट दे हैव टू बिकॉज़ इट डिपेंड्स ऑन हाउ इज योर कैमराडरी विद योर सीनियर मैनेजमेंट और योर बॉसेस.
सिचुएशन इन एनी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन इज नॉट गुड. And if you don't have anyone to support you in that organization from the top, you are never secure. No one is secure.
Journalists have always been about their stories. Their stories have always been hidden from public purview. This secret wall between inadequacies within their newsrooms and the responsibility they carry on their shoulders to not be the story themselves but to only seek external truth and report it has made them more vulnerable in their own professional lives. Many now feel that it is time to unite and address the common concerns.
We as journalists won't hold each other's hand. We don't care for each other. Nobody else will. As community, we should be together. These are the times when you have to realize that the world is very cruel. The coming days are going to be very tough. So let's hold our hands. Let's be together and let's support each other.
I think the good journalists and good people will get together simply because of what has either been done to them or how they've been treated. And this is not senior, junior, this is across the spectrum.
As they say, journalism holds the mirror up to society and a nation gets the journalism it deserves. Constant bickering between major news organizations has made media the worst enemy of the media. Many feel media not only has to bring the power to account, but also hold itself accountable and must be beyond reproach.
Journalism is a public trust. Making yourself more accountable to your reader or your viewer or your listener is much more important than just driving revenues through advertisement.
To me, journalism is a sacred profession because it means people listen to you and you have to be worthy of that. You have to earn the right to tell them something. And when you earn the right to tell people something that you think is important, you automatically must respect another person who is doing it as well. Doesn't matter where that person comes from.
The pandemic has also been an equalizer or a leveler in many ways. It has cut the senior-junior hierarchy in the industry. Most working journalists feel the common suffering has made everyone equal. And now, what matters is only the story.
The violence of the pandemic is so terrible that there are no seniors and juniors in this, in what we're all facing.
There is something about being a journalist at the time of a tragedy. You know, being able to witness this is something which I think we're going to talk to our, people who follow us in this world for decades and for decades.
The news media industry has seen so many twists and turns in the last so many years. that some seniors in the industry feel it is no longer a safe career option for the youth.
I am discouraging all the young students. I tell them that, you know, journalism for first 5 to 10 years is fine, but then branch out after that, because even the employers are looking for fresh face and, you know, whom they can hire for lesser amount.
While some others feel journalism schools should stop treating the profession as just an industry for jobs, but get the students grounded to reality.
There are a lot of these, you know, sort of hot shops that churn out journalists on an annual basis without necessarily thinking about whether all of them want to be journalists for the sake of journalism, or is it just something which has become like an industry for jobs. Inside these journalism schools, very little emphasis is put on preparing a journalist for what to expect.
The confusion and the chaos and the prevailing job scenario in the news media industry has given rise to a lot of apprehension amongst the student community. Many students fear that the industry may not have a place for them considering the current situation. But senior journalists feel journalism is also about optimism. It's about perseverance. It's about struggle.
When you start out in the profession, we all know you should not expect high salaries. You should expect that you will not get a byline, you will not get in front of a camera, that you will not be famous. For several years, you may never actually reach that stage. You might actually have to work for years behind the cameras before you actually get in front. That slog work that is intrinsic to a good journalist.
Anybody who's a journalism student and who's wondering what will he or she do, I think there are always opportunities. You just need to be humble enough, be open enough, and be ready to rough it out.
Journalism is an act of faith in the future. It is not what it's taught to be in journalism schools. When what is taught is not even close to reality, most youngsters feel disillusioned with what they see when they take up their first jobs.
These journalism schools that try and tell people that all that matters is getting in front of a TV screen. All that matters is getting your byline in the newspaper tomorrow and being able to Google yourself or to have Twitter followers. In fact, they should be saying all that matters is the journey, the process. This is how you do great journalism. And eventually what you do will be your reward, not how soon you can be sitting in front of, in a studio in front of cameras or, pontificating of an op-ed page.
There are some within the industry who have suffered so much that they don't have anything to say to budding journalists except their own tales of trauma and turbulence.
Right now I feel like I am a loser. A loser cannot, can't suggest to the budding journalist or the young journalist. But I don't have any path or any way to suggest them what they should do, because I lost my own battle. Main ek hara hua aadmi. To jo ek hara hua aadmi hai, wo dusre ko rasta nahi dikha sakta.
And there are some others who feel that there is light at the end of the tunnel. But as they say, the way out is through the tunnel.
Number one, it's a wonderful profession. I mean, I wouldn't be anything else. I couldn't do anything else. It's taught me so much, so much. If you can afford, try and get other skills. Develop writing skills or develop domain expertise in any domain. And keep the faith. Because this too will pass.